Well, hi there. My name is Brent Smith, and I'm the Common Constitutionalist, and this is Common Constitutionalist, Common Constitutionalist Weekend Video Podcast. I'm doing it indoors. I don't like doing it indoors, but today was sunny. It was really cold and really windy, and so that was done. And so rather than do the audio, I just picked a spot in the house and whatever. Here we go. All right, so we're going to be discussing three topics today. The first is there's a town in Quebec that needs to, or wants to, or seeks to change its name. The second is I've called it tax deductible propaganda. It's about a newspaper. And the third is it okay to text okay? We'll just leave it at that. So that's what I'll be discussing today on the Common Constitutionalist Weekend Video Podcast. I'll be right back. You're watching the Common Constitutionalist Weekend Video Podcast. This thing started, shall we? So there is a town in Quebec, France, Quebec, and the town is named Amiens. That's a French word. Amiens in English. This is the reason why they want to change their name. In English, Amiens means asbestos. So it's the town of asbestos, Quebec, Canada. So they should just leave it as Amiens and leave it at that. I don't understand what the problem is. They speak French in Quebec, so why not just leave it at Amiens? But everybody knows of it as asbestos. So I'll get into the background here real quick as why it's called asbestos, or the French word for asbestos. So this is from Newser, and it's Amiens, or asbestos, is about 95 miles east of Montreal. That's where it is. So it's going out toward the Atlantic, so to speak. Officials in asbestos, you believe the town named asbestos? I love it. Oh, I think we'll name the town the Black Plague, Georgia. There you go. That sounds good. Let's go with that. All right, so anyway, officials in asbestos have decided that the town's name is holding it back. Really? The small Quebec town, site of the world's largest asbestos mine, there you go, says it will announce a new name next year, and residents are welcome to offer suggestions. Bubonic Quebec, probably not the best name either. You know, whatever, yellow fever, whatever, I don't know. Malaria. Okay, asbestos. What's that chemical that they use in the ortho weed killer? Maybe they can change it to that. That's the new thing, isn't it? Asbestos, once considered a miracle, back to newser.com. Asbestos, once considered a miracle mineral, and it still is a miracle mineral, so to speak, was widely used in construction material until it was linked to lung disease. Now, I will get into this at the very end of this segment because I know a little about asbestos. Okay. The name hasn't been much of an issue for French-speaking locals since the mineral is called Amiens in French, but officials say it has been very difficult to attract foreign investment, particularly from the United States, English-speaking, to the town of around 7,000 people. Incidentally, the mine closed in 2012. There is really... There is really a negative perception around asbestos, Mayor Hugh Guimard tells CBC, which is, I guess, the Canadian Broadcasting Center or something like that. Quote, we've lost lots of businesses that don't want to establish themselves here because of the name. He says that once a conference outside Quebec, people didn't even want to go near town officials wearing asbestos pins. I think they probably had amiant on there, but maybe they had asbestos, really bright. But there was a backlash online after asbestos announced plans for a name change, with some locals calling the idea an insult to the town's history. Okay, this person, which I will quote now, quote, "No need for Anglos to invest," although Anglos, you know, own some of the largest companies in the universe, but whatever. "Since I've lived here, the town has evolved without your English, sir," wrote Lynn Meyer. Okay, so Lynn, you have a point. If you don't want to grow the town, and there's something to be said to not growing a town into a city, and then you start to mimic big city, you have big city problems, and you start to look at other big cities and how many problems they have and how they solve them, which is actually making problems worse. So why don't you just keep your little town as a little town, and as long as it's working for you, go for it, whatever. So mesothelioma, lung disease, asbestosis, whatever. Despite the humor in this, those are serious ailments, cancers, whatever. Here's what it is. This is the great myth about asbestos, that anyone can get mesothelioma, anybody can get lung disease from asbestos, anybody can get asbestosis from asbestos. That is an absolute falsity. Just because you win a bunch of money in court doesn't make the science real, okay? Just like global warming is not a settled science. None of this stuff is settled science, because when the mesothelioma thing first came out, and it's pretty much run its course, every once in a while you'll see one of those silly commercials about mesothelioma, and I'll get to that in a second. But basically, the bottom line is that yes, it causes cancer, but no, it's really, really difficult to get mesothelioma. It just is, and here's the reason why. You have to know something about the mineral itself. AAA asbestos, which is the premium asbestos, that's what most asbestos products were made of, shingles and insulation and things like that. And in my business, sealing materials. Not sealing materials above you, but sealing for stopping leaks and things. That's my day job. At any rate, asbestos is a mineral, but it's a fibrous mineral, and it has these tubular fibers, and a AAA asbestos mineral fiber is about 3/8 of an inch long. That's about 3/8 of an inch long. But it's like a straw. It's hollow inside. So the asbestos has like a kernel on the outside, a hard shell, as it were. And then on the inside, it's called, there's the asbestos small tiny little fibers inside called the water of crystallization. And when the asbestos is broken up and the water of crystallization is released into the air, it can be breathed in. And now the lungs and the esophagus have these little hairs, micro hairs called cilia, all right? Normally when you cough, the cilia work and they expel whatever you coughed, whatever dust you coughed and whatnot. It's not going to expel it all, but it's going to get most of it. And for the larger fibers and things like that, it's going to expel it out. Now, by larger fibers, I'm talking like really, really tiny, these water crystallization fibers that lodge themselves in the lungs. The problem was with mesothelioma, lung disease, this type of thing, is that during World War II, it was used a lot in insulation and aboard ships, Navy yards, and whatnot. What was the common denominator for almost everybody that worked in those places that got mesothelioma? The common denominator was not just asbestos. Is that most of the workers that got this disease were smokers. What does that have to do with anything? It has everything to do with it. Here's the deal. Smoking anesthetizes the cilia. It puts them to sleep. So the cilia is doing this when you're breathing in and out, coughing, and it goes, and it expels the stuff back out of your out of your windpipe and back out into the air, so it can't harm you. That's what the cilia does, all right? When you anesthetize the cilia, you put it to sleep, you paralyze it by cigarette smoke. It just sits there. It lays there, and when you cough, it doesn't do anything. And it just sits there and doesn't do anything. So the water of crystallization inside the asbestos straws or tubes gets lodged in the lung tissue or the lung cilia, and it builds up, and that's what causes mesothelioma and other lung diseases caused by asbestos. That's the common denominator. If you're a non-smoker and you have healthy lungs, healthy esophagus, healthy cilia, you're not bloody likely, it's damn near impossible to get mesothelioma unless you're mainlining it, okay? Unless you're breathing in like cocaine through a straw or something like that, and you overwhelm the system, so to speak. But if you're just around asbestos, you can't get mesothelioma. Frankly, even if you're a smoker and you're not in the production phase or it's not flying around because of asbestos insulation and whatnot, which we don't have anymore, you're not likely it's damn near impossible to get mesothelioma. That's why there aren't many cases anymore, just because if you're not predisposed to getting cancer, this type of cancer, you're not going to get mesothelioma. Even if you're a smoker these days, there's just not enough around it. But when you're working in the Navy Yards or you're producing asbestos, the fibers are everywhere. They get crushed. The minute they get crushed, the minute they get somehow, the water of crystallization is separated from the outer shell of the mineral fiber, of the asbestos fiber, that gets expelled into the air. That gets breathed in. Because you're a smoker, the cilia is asleep. It won't do anything. It won't react the way it's supposed to. And you get a buildup of asbestos fibers, and that's what causes the disease. So it is a big myth. It's a big crock, and it's a big lie that anyone could get mesothelioma. It's like this, the ortho weed killer thing. Just because a jury or a judge says it's so, and the company that manufactures it gives up and says, "Uncle," doesn't make it so. Doesn't make the science so. Okay? It's the same with the weed killer. Asbestosis, mesothelioma, these types of lung diseases are damn near impossible to get unless you're wallowing in this stuff and you are a smoker. Okay? Those are the two things that set this apart from all other, you know, from other cancers and whatnot, from without. Okay? So I'm going to take a break, but I just thought that was important to share, despite the silliness of this article. On a PR front, a public relations front, should they change the name? Hell yeah, they should change the name. To what? I don't know. Friendly. The town of Friendly. The town of, I don't know. Bienvenue. I don't know what it should be. But you're right. They're right. Most people are right, except for this Lynn Meyer person. They should change the bloody name. I mean, they closed the plant down. They have nothing to do with asbestos anymore. Just change the name. That's it. So I'll be back after this break.
You're watching the Common Constitutionalist Video Podcast.
Alrighty then, I'm back. Next segment, tax deductible propaganda. This is a little irksome to me. So let's just get into it, and then I'll give you my thoughts, maybe throughout, if I can. I probably can't hold my tongue, so, you know, that's just me. This is from the Seattle Times. The publisher of the nation's first daily newspaper to be granted nonprofit status says he's heard from a few dozen lawyers and news executives curious about whether the Salt Lake Tribune's approach could work elsewhere. So the Salt Lake Tribune may be granted by the IRS nonprofit status. It gets better. Tribune publisher Paul Huntsman learned earlier this month that the Internal Revenue Service had approved the paper's plan to become a public charity, which lets people, this is it gets really good, I guess, depending on your perspective, which lets people claim a tax deduction for donations to support its journalism. Honestly, really? That's a stretch. I don't understand why the IRS is doing this. If you can't survive, you simply just go out of business or you find something else, you know, whatever. I don't know. So it's an intriguing new option for newspaper owners laid low by the industry's financial struggles. That it is. Everything's going online. I know of maybe two or three people that actually physically read a paper newspaper. I don't. I get everything online that I need. Whatever. That's just me and millions of other people. The overwhelming majority of Americans get their news online. Hell, the overwhelming majority, it seems like the majority of people get their news on Twitter and Facebook. Yeesh. That's another story. I'm surprised. This is Huntsman speaking, the owner of the Salt Lake Tribune. Quote, "I'm surprised, quite frankly, that I'm the first one doing this," Huntsman said. Quote, "I'm not a journalist. I saw how broken the model really was. I was wondering, why isn't there anybody doing something about this instead of waiting for someone to come rescue us?" Unquote. Good point, Mr. Huntsman. Huntsman, son of wealthy industrialist John Huntsman, who was a really, really great American. I cannot say that about any of his children. Yes, I cannot say that about any of his children, but John, the apple did fall far from the tree for the Huntsman family, but John Huntsman was a great and giving American. Huntsman the son, bought the Tribune in 2016 from the hedge fund that had been operating it. His chief mission was to keep it alive. The Tribune had a staff of 148 people in 2011. The paper said earlier this month that they were now down to about 60 employees. He figured he had about 5 to 10 years to settle on a strategy, but quickly learned that that was optimistic. That's for sure. You're going to be out of business in 5, maximum, in my opinion. Quote, "This was strictly about trying to figure out a pathway to sustainability rather than figuring out a rate of return," unquote, Huntsman said. The Tribune's nonprofit, I cannot believe this is happening. The Tribune's nonprofit status requires Huntsman to transfer ownership to a public board of directors with protections built in to ensure donations don't compromise the independence of its journalism. Who picks the public board of directors, I wonder? Does the paper? Does the government? Who picks these people? Are they going to be like a representative from the Southern Poverty Law Center? Media Matters? Soros' Open Society? Who's going to be sitting on the board of directors, I wonder? And how nonpartisan will they be, I wonder? This is ridiculous, in my opinion. Besides Huntsman negotiating himself out of a job, he doesn't need a job, thanks to his father, his Faja. The paper will no longer be able to endorse candidates in political races. Tragic. These steps may alone give pause to independent newspaper owners who enjoy the power and influence of their positions. Independent? Independent of what? Independent of the Democrat Party? Not likely. Beyond that, most newspapers are part of chains of ownership interested in profit. No, they're not. They're interested in a leftist agenda. That's not profitable. That's just a leftist agenda, like the New York Times. Weren't they sold for like, oh no, it was the Boston Globe, was sold for like $1.50 or something. I don't know what it was. It's not a panacea, quote unquote, said industrialist Ken Doctor. Doctor? Okay. The Tribune will be allowed to continue to sell advertising and charge for a subscription and individual copies. Now, the advertising, I wonder, are they going to be allowed to charge for political advertising, I wonder? How the hell is that going to work? How is that going to be fair and balanced? Get it? Who's gonna, is the board of a public board of directors gonna decide on what type of advertising is allowed? What's it gonna be? Shoes and cars? I don't know. Monster trucks, SUVs? Well, they cause global warming, don't you know? So who's gonna be in charge of this nonsense? This is a, as we conservatives like to say, a slippery slope, don't you know? And it is, as usual. Anytime the government gets involved and decides things for us, they're not only wrong, but it's a recipe for disaster later on, okay? It's just the first cog in the wheel, so to speak. Continuing on both tracks is crucial for the idea to succeed, Doctor said. It's still possible for a newspaper to receive donations and grants, even if it's a non-profit. But the tax deduction is the important advantage. Boy, howdy, you're not freaking kidding me. Utah may be particularly well-suited to the non-profit approach with a community that has indicated its willingness to support the paper, he said. Some people in the news industry may have been reluctant to try this idea because of doubts that the Internal Revenue Service wouldn't be interested, said lawyers Megan Biss and Doug Varley of the Washington firm Kaplan and Drysdale. Yay, the DC firm Kaplan and Drysdale, who helped put together the Tribune's application. But the IRS will listen to a good, legally sound argument, they said. There had been some question about whether the IRS would limit the scope of the Tribune's coverage to comply with its educational mission. Okay, right there, that's scary enough. Whose education? From what source would this education come, I wonder? Oh, jeez. Such as cutting out sports. Sports? Sports is about as nonpartisan as you get. Yeah, you might like a team and you might hate another team, but that's not partisanship necessarily. That's just fandom, okay? Huntsman said he's happy to share his experience with other publishers in the hopes that the Tribune's idea could spread and be useful throughout the industry. Oh yeah, that's going to be really useful. Let's give to the Washington Post and deduct our taxes. Let's give to the Globe or the New York Times, the LA Times, or any one of these dozens and dozens and hundreds of leftist websites and newspapers. That'll be great. We need good journalism, he said. Yes, we do. We don't have it, but we need some. Quote, we have to continue support it in our state and hope others will see it the same way, unquote. I think I've said enough of this. You know where I stand on this. This is a ridiculous idea. It's a slippery slope. There's no way that you can, particularly these days, journalism is supposed to be reporting. Okay, you report the facts. You have the advantage to be able to send people out and you report the facts to the people that aren't there so they know the facts. That's not what journalism is these days. Journalism is taking down President Trump. Journalism is taking down conservatives. Journalism is absolute naked partisanship these days. How are you going to keep that out of this newspaper is utterly beyond me. Frankly, the only way you could do it is just have all sports all the time. That would keep it out, for the most part. So I just think that this is a really stupid idea, and if the IRS goes along with this, which it looks like they're going to do, I don't understand this for the life of me. I just don't get it. So that's all I got on that segment. I'll be back with a snowflake update. Yeah, buddy, that'll be fun.
You're watching the Common Constitutionalist Video Podcast.
Yeah, baby! Yeah.
All right, I am back for the last segment of today. This segment is called You Just Can't Text OK. 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 Is that Eddie Murphy? I guess it was on Saturday Night Live. But we, okay. Wow, that couldn't be played these days now, could it? Wow. Okay, so Nick Douglas urges, I guess Nick Douglas is the author of this thing. This is from Newser also. Nick Douglas urges you to at least use an exclamation point if you're going to say, okay. Jeez. Think okay and yes are good responses in a text? Yep. Yeah, they are. If so, please use an exclamation point to sound more positive, at least according to freelance writer Nick Douglas, who undoubtedly is a snowflake. Quote, otherwise, man, these people are pathetic. Quote, otherwise, you might sound passive-aggressive, dismissive, or angry, unquote, he writes at Life Hacker. He needs to get a life, Hacker. Quote, there's a good reason for this, unquote, drawing on the work of linguist Gretchen McCullough. I've got all her latest albums. I don't know who that crap she is, other than she's a linguist. A linguist. Douglas says you make, quote, an extra effort, unquote, to be polite in daily life, asking people things instead of bossing them around. Okay is bossing somebody around? How you doing? Okay. Oh, no, I'm so offended by that. What? I don't know. Okay, quote, online you do the same with different tactics, he said. Or he writes, excuse me. Said tactics include the exclamation point, as well as more casual forms of speech like yep and sure thing. Actually, to be honest with you, I think sure and sure thing is more dismissive and angry than okay and yes. Okay is positive, yes is really positive. I don't get what the problem is, but then I don't take offense to these kinds of nonsensical things because I'm not a freaking snowflake. But even there, Douglas says, it's best to exercise caution. Yes, you wouldn't want to upset the little dumplings. Whatever. Oh boy. So anyway, imagine saying, he says, this is Douglas, I guess. Yep, it is. Imagine saying yes in an empty tone with no facial expression, and you get how it reads in a text. Yes. Were you offended by that? Sounded like a lurch.
Yes.
With no facial expression, and you get how it reads in a text, where nothing else indicates emotion. Perhaps, oddly, Douglas doesn't mention emoji. So you could put yes with a little smiley face, or a little clappy thing, or a heart, or something fancy. So you wouldn't upset the little snowflakes, because yes, as we know, is now a negative term. I don't know, we're in some sort of opposite world or something like that. He admits that these rules change by time and culture. Yes, they certainly do. And we are in a culture of absolute pathetic, weeny pansies. I said it. Boo freaking who. For you pansies. Don't take offense. And some people overdo exclamation marks. I have a tendency to do that. I wish people birthday wishes on Facebook, and I put like two or three exclamation marks. I don't know what that's supposed to mean. It's like,
yeah, have a good day. Acha.
I don't know. But be careful if you're the only one in a group who doesn't use them. Oh, tragic. So you're supposed to go back and read everybody's remarks, count all the exclamation marks, and then what? Post the average exclamation mark. What if there's 100 comments or 100 remarks? You got to go back, you got to add them all together, you got to divide them by 100, and then that's the amount of exclamation marks you use. That's too much freaking math for me. Thank you very much. But what if it's just a simple yes? You know, do you want burgers for dinner? Yeah. Or yes. It's not, yeah. I'm not, I mean, it's not lobster, man. It's so silly. What people get offended by, literally everything. Okay, so he admits that these rules change by time and culture. And some people overdo exclamation points, but be careful if you're the only one in the group who doesn't use them. Quote, if you're the most formal one in the group, then believe me, Everyone thinks you hate them. Really? Everyone thinks you hate them? Honestly? And if you're the only one that doesn't use exclamation marks, I mean, what if you're just having a normal conversation? Everybody else is using exclamation marks and you don't. And so what, if they block you because you're a hate monger, because you don't use exclamation? This is our... I hope that nothing really tragic happens to this country. Anything really bad. We get attacked. Or something, you know, some sort of huge natural disaster or whatnot. I swear, over half the population is just gonna jump under a table, get into the fetal position, and wait for somebody like me or like you to come save them, the sheepdogs to come save them, because they're so pathetic that they can get wounded by somebody just saying yes or okay, and not have an exclamation point or a smiley face or a heart emoji or some other stupid. It's just so, people are so pathetic these days, it makes me ill. Other than that, I ain't got nothing strong to say about it. So, exclamation point. There, exclamation point. All right, whatever. This is Brent Smith. I'm the Common Constitutionalist. And wishing you and yours the balance of the holiday weekend the holiday week has been good. The weekend has been great. I hope everybody got home safe. Certainly, I haven't heard of anybody not getting home safe, minding my loved ones or friends who travel. And that's all I got.
See you.